God gave the people the instructions. Go out and gather enough food, but only for the day. I tend to think that there's a lot of people in our world even today that could handle that instruction better than we can as Americans who need to always have more and more and more. When I visited with friends in places like India or friends in Scotland, something they have in common is very different from the way we operate in America. They have really small refrigerators. And in those small refrigerators, they seem to have only enough room for food for that day. As a matter of fact, it is the tradition still in many cultures around the world in 2018 for people to go to the market on a daily basis. They go there and they buy their fresh fruits and vegetables and the meat that they need for that day, the bread that has just been baked for that day, and they'll go back again the next day and the next day and the next day. Sometimes I find that that pattern would just simply be annoying. Why not just go at the beginning of the week and plan out your menu and know what you're doing the whole week long? But the problem is that in many cultures, the food would still spoil if it weren't refrigerated well. So, can you have enough food for just the day? We started the school year, right? And everyone seems to be going back to school. And so the dilemma that is facing Americans is, when will we as a family actually see one another throughout the school year? With all the going back and forth and running and going and school and practice and school and practice and meeting and church and work and school and practice and school and practice, you can barely find yourself coming and going. So you need to find a time and a place to sit down and hopefully have a family meal. And since the year 2015, something has drastically changed, and I don't think it will ever go back in America. 2015 was the first year Americans spent more money eating out than they spent going to the market. More money eating out at restaurants than they spent for the full year going to supermarkets. Now, that might sound crazy, or that might sound exactly like you, right? So do you spend more money at the supermarket or more money eating out? Do you spend more time at the table in your dining room or your kitchen, or more time using the table that's provided for you at McDonald's or Applebee's or that fancy place called Buca di Beppo? What is it? Where is your table? Do you spend more time and money eating out or more time and money going to market? When I think about the ancient people, they obviously spent more time at market. And I think about people in other cultures. They realize that they have needs for that day, and they go and have them provided for them. And so let's get into that mode a little bit as people who most likely eat out, but imagine having food that is only good for the day. The ancient people in Jesus' time had been fed a wonderful meal. It tells us in the Gospels that Jesus fed them with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and he fed 5,000 men, plus the women, plus the children. And where we pick up in John chapter 6 today is right after Jesus had fed the thousands. And then he sent his disciples to the other side of the lake. And then that night, remember what he did? He started walking on water, and he freaked them out. They thought they had seen a ghost, but in reality, it was just Jesus. And Jesus got into the boat. He calmed down the storm, and they got to the other side of the lake. But the crowds were hungry. They needed food for their day, and they knew that Jesus could perhaps be their meal ticket. And so they run to Jesus. Do you notice that about people in the Bible? I don't really think it's very much different with people in our world right here and now. That many people run to Jesus for different needs, and they run to Jesus at various times of their lives. I meet a lot of people as a pastor who are looking for help in their life. They're looking for a little bit of God, a little bit of Jesus in their life, and I'm always honored when they want to have a discussion about Christ in their life. I notice that sometimes people this time of year are praying those desperation prayers that take them running to Jesus. They pray, Jesus, help my kids as they're going into fourth grade, or as they're going into high school, or help my child as they're moving away to college. And then that desperation prayer, Jesus, help me as my kid goes away to college. Oh, Jesus, help my bank account to handle my kid going away to college. It's a desperation prayer to Jesus. Sometimes that prayer is when you're flat on your back and you are brought down by an illness you didn't expect. You're maybe in your bedroom or maybe in the hospital room and you're looking up into the ceiling tiles and you're saying, you know, Jesus, I know you're up there above the ceiling tiles, and if you're willing to listen, I could use your help. It's a prayer of running to Jesus in a time of desperation. Many people do that in their sadness and in their grief. Oftentimes, people that don't even have a relationship with a church will then, in a time of sadness and grief, turn to the ministry of a church to bring comfort. Many times throughout the course of a year, we'll get phone calls from our funeral home director friends, and they'll ask, can you help out a family who doesn't have a church? They need someone to lead a memorial service. And as much as I'm able to do it, I am honored by a chance to talk about Jesus, even to people who really haven't spent much time in one of his many houses in our community. People run to Jesus for different needs at different times in their lives. And it's really easy to get kind of upset about that, especially if we are members of the church and we try to run to Jesus in our lives. And though we do it imperfectly, though we do it as flawed people, we're trying to run to Jesus often. And then sometimes it's easy to let a bitter root grow when we see people only turning to him in desperation. Now, notice what happens when these people come running to Jesus, desperate for another free lunch. Does he turn them away? Does he say, no, you haven't taken membership classes yet, we can't serve you? Does he say, no, you're not a card-carrying member of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, we can't serve you? Does he say, no, by last time I checked my calendar, you haven't been at an appointment with me since 1953, we can't serve you? No, he doesn't, does he? He welcomes people to come to him, because who is working to draw people to Jesus, regardless of the reason that they think that they are there? They think that they might be calling out to him because they're desperate for help for their kids or their finances or their career. They think that they might be just looking for a little bit of word of comfort about grandma or grandpa who is lying dead in the casket. They think that they are just doing it as a last-ditch effort in hopes that someone might listen to them and heal them. But in reality, it is the Holy Spirit who is drawing people to Jesus. Jesus himself said that no one can come to me unless the Father draws them. And the Apostle Paul said in the book of Philippians that whether people are hearing of Jesus because of false motives or true motives, I rejoice, says Paul, because Christ is preached. We can rejoice when people run to Jesus because Jesus is there in full for them. He greets the people that are coming for a free lunch. He knows that they were just looking for food, not necessarily acknowledging him as the worker of miracles and signs, as the Messiah who came from God. And yet he spoke to them in John chapter 6. He said to these hungry, stomach-grumbling people, do not work for food that spoils, but work for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval. Jesus knows the history of God's ancient people. He knows that the bread that is there for the day will have maggots in it by tomorrow. He knows that God has taught his ancient people to be fully reliant upon him as the one who reaches forth his hand and satisfies the desires of every living thing. And he knows that. But he also knows the heart of broken humanity, that we will always choose the food that spoils as opposed to the fresh food. And yet, what does Jesus offer? Fresh food. He is giving fresh food away. Food that endures. He is offering it for free. But people often choose the food that spoils. As a matter of fact, he's talking about God the Father feeding people, whether they thought it was Moses and in reality was God, whether they thought it was a little boy with 5 loaves and 2 fish and thought it was just a lucky day for them, it was God feeding them. Whether they saw it, whether they realized it, whether they knew it or not, the Father was there with the fresh food that endures. And yet, what do people choose? They choose food that spoils. Can you think of some of those kinds of food that people fool themselves into thinking will never spoil, but we all know that it does? Many people go through their day-to-day life, and they want to eat the food that is the food of success, and they want to continue to feed the hunger of success. They want to continue to go to the restaurant of success and the marketplace of success. They want more of the money, more of the power, more of the influence. They want beauty, and so they spend gobs of money to try to make themselves beautiful, sometimes even to their own detriment. They want wit and smarts, and so they spend gobs of money trying to impress people with their advanced degrees and how they have climbed the ladder in their workplaces. They want to have more social networks. They want to engage more and more people and brag about the number of friends that they have or the number of likes that have been dropped on their account on YouTube. And they want more and more and more. And yet, what always happens, that one day the success that was there right in our office and at our desk will be gone. One day, the IRA that was performing so well won't perform so well at all. One day, the influence that we think that we will have won't be there any longer, and someone else will move up to take our place. One day, that the beauty that we so treasured and tried to preserve and protect and defend will be taken away. One day, we too will come into that point where we realize that if Jesus was just some kind of good luck charm, and if God was just some kind of an insurance policy to get me more success or more money or hopefully more power or hopefully more influence or hopefully a better life, that if Jesus has only been a means to my end, he will seem to fail me. And so I meet many people who have said, well, yeah, I tried the church thing for a while. I tried the Christian thing for a while. I tried the Jesus thing for a while, but you know what? It just wasn't working for me. It might work for you, but it doesn't work for me. And you know what happens every time someone says that? They have chosen to make Jesus a means to their end instead of the end and the goal himself. And so if we see Jesus not as a means to an end, not as a ticket to a free meal, but the full meal deal himself, he will never fail. If we see Jesus not as our key to success, or our key to wealth, or our key to influence, but he himself as the way, the truth, and the life, he will never fail. For he is not the food that spoils like the rest of the world, but instead he is the food that endures. The food that can be brought down even into the trench of death and yet be raised up on the third day to give us life. The food that can be seemingly filled with maggots on a Friday night and into a Saturday, but on Sunday morning it's back again, risen like bread that rises and smells so good for all the world to enjoy. Jesus said to them in John chapter 6, "Very truly I tell you, it wasn't Moses who has given you this bread from heaven, but it's my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." So what's this bread that the manna in the wilderness foreshadowed? What's this bread that the five loaves and the two fish were a prequel of? What's this bread that has been previewed for us every time we gather at the table like we will do today? It's Jesus. It's Jesus in all his fullness. It's Jesus who says in John chapter 10, "I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." So bread is a picture of life, and bread that endures is Jesus. So for centuries, my friends, Christians have used different types of bread to communicate different things. Think about the bread that we use in the Lord's Supper. Think about the bread that we use so that it can be broken as a reminder of Jesus being broken for us. Well, another type of bread tends to be one of my favorite symbols of the Christian faith. Those who know me well know that I have several weaknesses when it comes to culinary delights. One of them is curried Indian food. The other one is a good, solid pretzel. Do you like pretzels? If you like pretzels, stop by and see me after church today. I've got some good pretzels for you. And the story of the pretzel actually goes back, it's believed, to the year 600 or so. And then around 600, there was a monk who actually invented the pretzel, or in his language was a pretiola, which means a little reward. And so a little pretzel, piece of bread, would be given as a little reward to a kid as they memorized their Bible lessons, as they learned to recite the Lord's Prayer and the Creed, as a little pretiola, a little reward to remind them about God. And so in the year 1111, a recipe for the pretzel first appeared in a cookbook in Germany. And to this day, you can't beat a German pretzel. But a pretzel is a symbol for God. You know, there's two natures to Jesus. He's both God and man at the exact same time. And there's also three persons to our triune God. If you look at a pretzel, you see that there are three openings in it. A reminder of the Father who is the baker, of Jesus who is the bread, of the Spirit who is the bread delivery guy who brings it into your life. And as those two pieces of bread are folded across one another in a pretzel recipe, you can envision arms crossed in prayer. That just as Jesus gave his life upon the cross for you, so in response to Jesus, we pray and worship him and hold his word in our hearts. So, eat more pretzels, right? And when you do, it is a holy snack. It is a sanctified gift. And it is a reminder that Jesus is the true bread from heaven. As he says to us, he says, don't work for the food that spoils, but take the food that endures to eternal life, which the Lord will give you. And he has given that bread to you. His name is Jesus.